Thank you, Marco. Yeah, welcome to the last weather briefing in this year, in December. And at first, I have to make the presentation alone in my room. And greetings to Felix, but he is this week ill, but he hear us from at home. So best wishes, and but I'm not alone, but I make the presentation together with Insa. You see, one moment please. Now I see it all. Okay, I make this together with Insa. You see it in the images, in the image, and I'm here. You see my name. At first, it need a little. So now, yeah, here we both, and the rest you see here, the group, our students from our excursion to Bremerhaven. And at first, some words to the group. The 12 students study metrology at the Federal University of Applied Administrative Sciences, a long word. The 3 years they are studying in Langen and in other places in Germany, and at the end, most of them are forecaster, for example, for aviation. From this group, you see there is 2 from Deutscher Wetterdienst, 8 from military service, 1 Luxembourg, and 1 from Mali. It's also sometimes from Africa. And we looked 4 weeks to the vessel Polarstern, which is sailing from Bremerhaven to Cape Town, round about 1 month from November to December. Now the vessel is in Cape Town. All runs good, but we looked only virtual. We followed this trip from Langen aus, and at the beginning we visited Bremerhaven. You see us here in the climate house, and one look to the city, to the small city of Bremerhaven. And this is our vessel, Polarstern, and one moment. So, and you can see in the Eumetrain science block, here you find the address, all the reports from the group, from different stations, the last block will come in the next days. And today, I will say at first something here. Eumetsat, a big thank to Eumetsat that we can write our blog, and Natalie and Neil Fletcher helped us a lot in this case. So, but before I continue, I please you that you give your sign where you live, where you stay, and perhaps if you are with some people in a group, please write your group number, perhaps 10 people, a class in other countries. Okay, it's also one from Tunis. One other country. Ah, we have some from Africa. You can also write your some letters where you come from, if you find it, this tool. Okay, our class is complete with 11. Okay, so we are more in the central part of Europe, not so much from south and north and east. Okay, good. So I then Thank you very much for this overview. In the first part, I give you some interesting information, what the students made in the last weeks, what you can find in the blog more in the detail. I have a first spot in the week number one. You see here Polarstern started in Bremerhaven. After 3 days, we had a first working day at 14th in the Biscaya, and this is a natural color RGB with typical the difference between water cloud, ice cloud, snow here in the Alps or in Pyrenees, and so this was a description. And in the next slide, I will ask you something. We have special channels in the red, green, and blue color. My question is, what are the correct channel combination in the natural color RGB? Please make a cross under the version or something else. What do you think? Okay, some of the first one and the second one. It's most for the first one. So I give the result. It's the second one because we have two important channels which help us. We have here the near infrared channel 1.6, and if we have ice clouds or snow on the ground, then the reflectivity is very low. So you see here on the cyan color there are a very small red contribution, but we have a lot of green and blue because these are WISP channels and is a big cloud. There is a big reflectivity, so we have less red and much green and blue. And so this is the combination for the ice clouds. And we need the WISP 0.8. It's our vegetation channel. And it's necessary that we take this channel in the green color. So if you have, you can also have another combination, but then you have total different colors, and it's a little, it's more difficult to understand this image. So this is the natural color. So, and then we come slowly to the subtropics area and in the direction of the Canarian Islands. And the students wrote a lot of climatology about the different climate zones. You can read this in details also about the subtropic area in the blog. And So it's interesting that we have in the North Africa, Southern Europe, but also South Africa is in the climate zone of the subtropic area. And in the next slide, I will show you it's not always sunshine in the subtropics. This was on the 17th November in the area of Madeira, and we had a cold front. You see it, you see here the cold front line, and Polarstern is sailing against this cold front. And I can say you, it's I spoke with some people on the vessel. Sometimes it's very difficult to make a forecast because the cold front is moving, and also the vessel is moving, and this is more difficult as you have a normal only one is moving. So in this kind, I think all runs good, all forecasts on the vessel. And here we have the natural color RGB with the cyan color for the frontal area with ice clouds on the top. And Polarstern was here at the end of this cloud band, nearly at 12 o'clock when the front is crossing. And you see it here, the passage of the cold front, that we have a wind veering from south to west roundabout at 12 UTC. So we have also a webcam on board, so we can compare this introduction from satellite with the webcam. And we see here in the webcam the typical stratiform clouds like nimbostratus. And if we want to describe this in detail, we go here to the synop, to the weather, to the synoptical code from our weather observer on board. And on we had light rain without interruption at this time at 12 UTC, and we see here in the cloud group, we have a cumulus fractus. These are here the cumulus fractus, and we have the nimbostratus. This here are the nimbostratus, a little big, but you can see it. And so we can compare all the different observation tools and bring this together in one case. This was also the same situation, 12 UTC, and the air mass RGB. And where do we expect the jet stream in this air mass RGB? Perhaps do you pin a line or with a pencil? Yeah, good. Yeah, it's really good. The left part is really exactly, and I will show you the answer. So we looked here to the jet core of this subtropical jet axis. And you make it correctly, it's around about here on this changing of the color from bluish to on this line. You see here the color changed from blue to red, and this was correctly. It's a little tricky. Sometimes you can you think perhaps here is a jet stream. You have here this transverse cloud bands, and this is also a good indicator for the jet stream or for turbulence. So there is a big difference in the speed of the air. But in this case, it's more it's better you follow the color change rule from blue to red in this kind. But the jet goes now more in the further in this direction and decreases in later. And we will highlight the area behind on the cold side of this jet stream, because you have here in point 5 or 2, so the reddish color, and it's typical for dry air that comes from the stratosphere and moves downwards in the troposphere, and this dry air brings the ozone downwards, and the air mass RGB included also the ozone channel. So, and in the combination of all channels, the ozone channel bring this reddish color to this image. And this is very helpful for dynamic weather situation. So, and then we are sailing in the direction of the equator, and well, we are passing at first the trade winds, and the northeasterly trade winds described in detail in our blog. And then it's always interesting what happened on the inner tropical convergence zone. We see here in a round of Polarstern there is a wind convergence between the trade winds, and it's normally we think there are thunderstorms, but the observer from Polarstern said to me, mostly it's a little boring if we are there are not so many strong convections. Sometimes they we are seeing nothing from a thunderstorm if we are crossing the inner tropical convergence zone. But in this year it was a little also not so heavy, but in the near of Polarstern there are something. We see here on this image there was a CB. It was at 18 UTC in the evening, and you see here the most hottest water, around about 29 degrees in this area, and a lot of potential for upwards motion of the warm air. And you see it here, this very high and strong convection, not in all cases. And on the next slide, I will ask you again a question. At first here, the typical, one moment please, I want to, yeah. You see here the strong updraft. We have it dark on the bottom of the CB, and on the tops the CB is, I think it's clear, it's bright, but we have on if you have strong convection, small ice particles. The question is, where, in which color do you see strong convection at the top of the CB? It is red, orange, or yellow. Now the most click to yellow. Or yeah, you are experts. Thank you. This is correct. And I think this is we checked this also and in this year, and we see very exactly the hotspots of this strong convection where you have a small yellow dot, and you see it was not directly in the area of Polarstern, but a little away in some cases, and this is very helpful to find the most hazardous weather situation, for example, for also for aviation and for all things. And this was a good situation to train this, because now in Germany or in Europe there is nothing of strong convection at this time. Here you see in the chart on the albedo for different particle radius. And you see, we have this image is very complicated. We have six different channels in one image, but the yellowish color comes from the infrared channel 3.9. It's very helpful in microphysics. And if we have small ice particles, then we have a very strong, you see the curve is going upwards, we have a very strong reflectivity, albedo in this case, and this brings the yellowish color. And we have reddish colors here in the area, then the particles are bigger and the reflectivity is not so much. This is, yeah, for example, the ice clouds, but without strong convections below. So, now, and we are coming to the southern hemisphere in the, yeah, we are south of the equator now, and in the subtropical regions, high pressure regions, there are a lot of, yeah, water clouds in different variations. You see Polarstern now with the arrow marked in such a reddish or a pinkish, light pinkish zone. And this is in the RGB day microphysics. It's another RGB special for, like the name microphysics, big, small droplets or ice crystals. And you can see here in this case, very good water clouds, in this case with big droplets and with large droplets with a strong hint for rain showers. If we see this now in Europe in winter situations, often we have drizzle in thick stratus clouds, and it's very helpful picture for this color. I think this is the most important color for me in this day microphysics. So, and here you, this was a from Polarstern, not in this year, an image. We had a cumulus congestus, but it's also run with stratocumulus clouds. And typical for the marine clouds is they have big droplets, bigger droplets as the continental clouds. And so the precipitation process is very better in continuing in starting if the droplets are, like in this drawing here, different, bigger droplets and smaller. And in the marine, we start with 20 micrometers. So if we have big droplets, water droplets, then we have this pinkish color. And if we check the three channels, now we have only three in this RGB day microphysics. I think it's very easy. We have the 0.8, the this channel, we have a bright image, a strong contribution in red because a high reflectivity. The 3.9 is the microphysic channel and the solar channel only. And we have big droplets, then the reflectivity is very, very low. This is typical for big droplets, so the green contribution is nearly zero or less. And we have more warm clouds because it's water and we are not below minus 10 degrees, so it's really warm. And so we have the typical contribution for this color and so the pinkish color, and this is really helpful. So, but now we come to December. We go back from back to Europe. We had also very interesting. The students wrote very interesting things about Passat, about the trade winds, and about a special wind. It's called Cape Ductor in Cape Town. Please look in the next days to the blog. Then there is a surprise in this, and they tell you what is Cape Ductor. So now come back to Europe today, 6 o'clock. Another situation, you see here a very long cloud band in the Atlantic, and on the rear side a very big trough with a typical shower situation. And this is the dust RGB. I think it's very helpful for starting the situation. We see here red for big and high cold clouds with rain. And we have on the eastern Europe more brownish colors. There is the second big player. Here's the big low, and we have here a big high pressure influence, mostly with mid-level clouds or low-level clouds in this brownish colors. And we have also one bigger area of low pressure in here in the region of Greece in the southern Europe area. So I can show you I see only one loop. I see only the AirMAS RGB, then we try this. From today, I hope you can see this. look here to the long cloud band on the Atlantic over Great Britain, and the very transverse bands. You see the jet stream very good. At the rear side here, the color change, and then the breaking cloud band here at the end. So I go to the next, to the briefing again. So yeah, this is you see this before. So you have here the situation on the surface chart with the fronts from 6 o'clock and with a very long cold front. And there is a wave, you see it in the air mass also, bigger area of clouds in this case, and here the big high pressure in the eastern part. So in our area, Germany and also Poland, the fronts are coming and they are dying in our region. You see here the rest of the front, a little rain, and it's the forecast is not so easy. You know not exactly how much comes from this old front. These are some webcam impressions from today in the morning, and you see in the left side the HRV image, satellite image. We start here in Warnemünde. It's on the Baltic seaside. We have a very little chaotic cloud situations here in the north. We have a small jet in the eastern part. There are also high clouds, but here we have also fog at the seaside. In the Hamburg area, you see also bigger clouds. Here in Offenbach, in the middle part, in the near we are sitting now, there are today, it's a little bright, some small sunny intervals, typical stratocumulus area. In this part, and the best place is near the Alps, Hohenpeißenberg. You see here blue sky because there is a little high pressure influence. It comes from southwest, and so it's a very nice impression here. I go back to the jet stream and to this weather situation. And today it was very important for the aviation, and it's a very heavy jet on this side here of this low. It goes over British Islands with a lot of severe warnings. It's called SIGMET in the aviation. You see here the reddish area. So if you fly today to America or through these areas, there are strong severe turbulence, and this is very pronounced today. We have also warnings, little warnings to icing, and in the Greece area to thunderstorm in the area of the slow. Okay, you see here the jet, the strong wind speed here in this area, and a very the isohypses are very small, the lines from one line to the other. So here is the pressure chart and the temperature from 500 HPA. It's typical here, the low with the cold air, and you see a second high low over Norway here in this area, and in France there is a ridge, and this ridge comes slowly also to Germany, and so the weather situation stabilizes a little. Yeah, these are the relative humidity and the wind arrows in 700 HPA, so it's a good help. It's helpful to see the cloud bands and in the western part, and also here the the big of moist area in the southeastern parts of Germany, and also here like a frontal structure, it goes to the north in this area. So now we come to the end, what happened in the next days, and today our colleagues published a nice image, so I will show you this, because in Germany we have always before Christmas, this is a long time period, we have normally a cold area in the mid of December, and exactly in this year it was so, we had a little snow in the last days, and it's typical if Christmas comes, the temperatures are rising with westerly winds, and you see this here in the Christmas evening, there is it's mostly warmer as the average line, and also on the Christmas days. And I think in this year it's exactly like in the average. So the next days we have more westerly or northwesterly winds here for Germany, and this is the 25th December, 12 UTC. So if you like cold and snowy Christmas, then you have to travel to the eastern part of Europe. For example, here the Baltic states are, I think they are very, it's very sure that it's cold at Christmas, perhaps also with snow. And we are here in the German area at the border of the two air masses, but it's more than 0 degrees, not so much snow in my opinion, and the others, the greenish area and the reddish area, they are out of snow and cold. You can look here into this part where you live, it's the temperature round about for Christmas day, in the southern area of Europe, perhaps 15 degrees and a little more in the middle parts, 5 to 10. And but also here in the southern Scandinavia, it's not so cold, but here in the Baltic states, it's below zero, and also in the eastern parts of Europe. So this was our small December weather briefing together with the student group and INSA, and we wish you all together Merry Christmas. And perhaps if there are some students are here, us, if you have any questions in relation how we study in Germany, or you are interested in this study, so you can write me. So I forgot my email address, but I write it now here in the chat line. I think it must run. And if you have questions, then you can tell this now.